Harper Audio presents Why Science Does Not Disprove God by Amir Aczel. Read by Grover Gardner. Introduction. In a televised debate about religion and science held at La Ciudad de las Ideas, the International Conference of Ideas in Puebla, Mexico, in November 2010, the prominent British evolutionary biologist and atheist Richard Dawkins took a novel tack. He argued that our understanding of physics is the new major source of proof that any assumption of a creator is unnecessary. By then, Dawkins had been using biology and evolution to argue against the existence of God for many years. I was there on the stage with Dawkins in Mexico, and the experience led me to the thesis of this book, that science has not provided any proof that the existence of a creator of some kind must necessarily be false. And in the chapters that follow, I will show that we have by no means reached the point at which people can claim in the name of science that God does not exist. When I heard Dawkins misuse concepts from mathematics and physics, episodes from my life as a professor of mathematics and statistics, as well as a science writer, flashed before my eyes. As an undergraduate at the University of California at Berkeley in the 1970s, I worked in the lab of Professor Gabor Samarjai, a physical chemist who was hoping to uncover the secret of life through processes taking place on a platinum crystal lattice. His theory was that catalysis on a primeval crystal surface hundreds of millions of years ago led to the evolution of life. Samarjai failed. Hard as he tried, he could never replicate the mysterious processes that produce life from inanimate chemical elements and compounds. His lack of success humbled him and gave him a renewed sense of wonder about the universe. He still made his name by contributing to the invention of the catalytic converter used in cars. I also remember learning the immensely complicated and surreal laws of quantum mechanics, first in an extraordinary lecture given at Berkeley by one of the greatest quantum pioneers, Werner Heisenberg, just a few years before he died, and later in advanced physics classes. These laws are so incomprehensible to us. As Richard Feynman said, if you think you understand quantum mechanics, then you don't understand quantum mechanics, that I was baffled to find that Dawkins and a number of cosmologists were trying to argue that these weird quantum rules bring about a universe out of nothing, and that therefore there is no God. As a science writer concentrating on mathematics, physics, and cosmology, I have marveled myriad times about what to me is one of the greatest mysteries of all. How, within the immensely hot and dense soup of particles that constituted our universe a fraction of a second after the Big Bang, the quarks suddenly gathered in threes, two ups and a down to form protons, and two downs and an up to form neutrons. How was it ever possible, I have asked myself, that the charges of these quarks turned out to be exactly two-thirds for an up and one-third for a down, with not even the tiniest of tiny errors, so that the proton would miraculously match the opposite charge of the electron, -1, and the neutron's charge would be precisely zero, just what is necessary to form atoms and molecules. How did such an incredibly improbable event ever happen without some calculated act of creation? And further, how did the masses of the elementary particles turn out to have the perfectly precise ratios needed so that our world of atoms and molecules could exist at all? How did the forces of nature, gravity, electromagnetism, and the weak and strong nuclear forces acting inside nuclei, as well as the mysterious dark energy that permeates space, receive just the right strengths they need to maintain a universe that has the required stability and neither collapses onto itself nor explodes before life has a chance to evolve? It is hard to imagine all this happening just by chance. Equally, having conducted a major study of consciousness and how it may have arisen in early hominids, for my book on Peking Man, The Jesuit and the Skull, for which I interviewed some of the world's leading anthropologists and prehistoric archaeologists, I have learned how much we do not know about consciousness, what it means, what it signifies as a stage of human development, and how it came about. In short, there's a great deal we have yet to understand even about ourselves, much less God. We have little idea about how the complicated eukaryotic cells in the bodies of living organisms emerged, and with them the complex life forms we see on Earth. In science, the fine-tuning of the parameters required for life has such an incredibly small probability to have arisen that the famous British cosmologist Stephen Hawking has described it as follows. If one considers the possible constants and laws that could have emerged, the odds against a universe that has produced life like ours are immense. And I think there are clearly religious implications whenever you start to discuss the origins of the universe. Another leading cosmologist, Roger Penrose, addressing only one of the many parameters necessary for a universe that would support life, has put the probability against the emergence of our universe as 1 over 10 to the 10th to the 123rd power, meaning 1 divided by 10 raised to the power of 10 raised to the power of 123. Such numbers are humbling. Now consider the odds of intelligent life developing. To assume that there was no God or act of creation behind our immeasurably unlikely universe seems to me presumptuous. So the idea of writing a book stating my conviction that modern science has not disproved the existence of God arose in my mind during the debate at La Ciudad de las Ideas, and later grew during 3 further annual sessions of this stimulating Congress. The Puebla Conference, which features some of the world's leading thinkers, writers, and academics, is the brainchild of a gifted individual, Dr. Andres Romer, a Mexican intellectual and television personality. Soon after I was awarded a Guggenheim Fellowship in 2005, Dr. Romer contacted me through the Guggenheim Foundation and asked if I would be interested in participating in his proposed first conference. We met in Cambridge, Massachusetts, and I immediately offered my help and participation. My debate with Dawkins was a small part of this larger enterprise. The past few years have seen the rapid growth of the idea that God and science cannot possibly coexist. I feel that many people who hold this view distort both the process of science and its value. Science is about the objective pursuit of truth. And we should be very skeptical when science is invoked to further someone's sociocultural agenda. The purpose of this book is to defend the integrity of science. I am of the firm belief that spirituality, religion, and faith have important roles to play in our lives. They keep us humble in the face of the great wonders of nature. They help maintain our social values, promoting the care for our weak and poor. And they provide hope and some moral code in our ever more complicated modern world. Science and spirituality are both integral parts of the human search for truth and meaning. They provide us possible paths of comprehending and appreciating the vast cosmos and our place in it. This book is not written from the perspective of any one faith tradition, nor does it seek to defend our often flawed religious institutions. My goal is to restore science and faith to their proper realms and end the confusion sown by those who aim to destroy faith in the name of science. As a science writer who has made a career of reporting on some of the most complicated and exciting advances in science and mathematics over the past quarter century, I realize that in publishing this book, I am taking a risk. In these pages, I am attacking the arguments of many prominent scientists and thinkers, and I understand that my doing so will likely lead to criticisms of my book. But I feel very strongly that the integrity of science has been compromised by some scientists and writers, and that it is important to set things straight and to restore the distinction between rigorous logic and improbable supposition. I thank very warmly and affectionately my good friend Andres Romer for his repeated invitations to me to participate in his Ciudad de las Ideas conferences, and to the organizers of the meetings for their hospitality. I also thank the people listed below with whom I have had the good fortune over the years to meet and discuss science and religion. I am immensely indebted to my literary agent, Albert Zuckerman, and to his dedicated staff at Writer's House for their work in supporting the project of writing this book. I am very grateful to Peter Hubbard, my editor at HarperCollins, for all his efforts and for believing in this book. Thanks also to editorial assistant Cole Hager, who was instrumental in making this project run smoothly. I thank the copy editor, Greg Villapique, for his attention to detail, as well as designer Diane Sturge for their help in producing this book. Prologue: The Birth of the New Atheism. The New Atheism movement was launched as a direct consequence of the attacks of September 11, 2001. The cold-blooded murder of thousands of unsuspecting innocent people on a beautiful late summer day horrified America and the world. These barbarous acts made many people justly regard with anger a religion that could even hint that its followers should commit such crimes in the name of God. How could any religion, supposedly based on the Word of God, lead people to indiscriminately destroy the lives of so many human beings, including, inevitably, some of their co-religionists? This was the question on many people's minds. One of the first writers to address these painful issues was Sam Harris, who within 3 years of the attacks published a book called The End of Faith, Religion, Terror, and the Future of Reason, 2004. Harris lambasted religion and questioned its value in our lives through the perspective of September 11th. He argued passionately that faith, indeed organized religion of any kind, has no place in the modern world, and that it brings only evil and destruction. And he stated his view that we may never be able to counter extremist Islam as long as we continue to hold on to our own religious beliefs. Militant religion, according to Harris, can only be fought against rationally and effectively by people who have shed their own faith. He later answered criticisms of his book, which had become an instant bestseller but had also generated controversy, in a second popular work, Letter to a Christian Nation, 2006. Though he is not a working scientist, Harris used scientific concepts to argue against religion. But the move from the justified moral outrage about 9/11 to a scientific argument against faith in general results in a somewhat condescending tone. Here is a sample of what he writes about science. All complex life on Earth has developed from simpler life forms over billions of years. This is a fact that no longer admits of intelligent dispute. If you doubt that human beings evolved from prior species, you may as well doubt that the sun is a star. Granted, the sun doesn't seem like an ordinary star, but we know that it is a star. And we know that it is a star that just happens to be relatively close to the Earth. Harris presents here some of the strong points of science. Most people today accept evolution as the mechanism for biological change, but his statements that the sun doesn't seem like an ordinary star and that it's a star that just happens to be relatively close to the Earth imply that religious people are as uninformed as children about science. Harris's argument against religion widens to all areas of modern life. One of the most pernicious effects of religion is that it tends to divorce morality from the reality of human and animal suffering. Religion allows people to imagine that their concerns are moral when they are not, that is, when they have nothing to do with suffering and its alleviation. Unfortunately, this notion is typical of the New Atheism. New atheists argue that there is no connection between religion and morality, often using examples of extreme cruelty such as rapes and murders of young children, as well as genocides, tortures, and other heinous crimes. Harris singles out religious people and says that their religion contributes to their failure to stop such atrocities. Hence, according
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.